Okay, welcome to Maida's NFX webinar. Today we will talk about meshing techniques with Maida's NFX. Before we start, I would like to ask you about the video and sound check. So if it's possible, please write me answer using the chat section. And then we will start the session. So I want to be sure that everything is fine according to the video and sound. Okay, so thank you for your feedback. So basically my name is Piotr Stepien. I'm a mechanical structural analyst. I have more than 10 years of professional experience of using FEA codes. So to my portfolio belongs Nastran, FEMAP. Right now I'm a Maida's NFX specialist, and here in Maida's IT I'm in charge of technical support for our business department. Also I know a little bit some other codes, and if you want to know something about FEA, you can reach me on mail that I will send you at the end of the presentation. But if you are looking for some other videos and other sessions, you can visit YouTube channel and typing the Maida's NFX. You will easily find our videos that we made in the past. So today we will talk about the meshing techniques, and this is the agenda for today's webinar. Basically, I would like to start from this title to explain what exactly is the meshing technique, because I would like to share with you how I understand this topic. So basically, when I'm thinking about meshing technique, I'm thinking about how to connect the different element types, especially with the different topology types, which is the main task, which is one of the main tasks of the FEA analyst. So in the same time, it's a very big challenge to assure the right connectivity between the nodes and elements, and this is why it's also important for final results. So this is the first thought which comes to my head when I'm thinking about meshing technique. And the second term or second definition which is related to the meshing technique is how to create the mesh effectively, how to create mesh depending on some other conditions like accuracy, how to make mesh very light to speed up the analysis, and other things that I will share with you. So basically, today I will start from a quick reminder about the FEM analysis. This will be a very brief introduction because we were talking about this many times. Then I will talk about the element types, and we refresh the knowledge about element properties. Then I will show you some example how to connect different types of the elements. So basically, I will show you the example how to connect the plate with the solid. And some of you probably know that it's very difficult, and in the normal way it's technically impossible because of the feature which is called degree of freedom, but I will talk about this a little bit later. Then I will review some manual meshing techniques, and from point number four, it will be extremely difficult to handle every aspect of the manual meshing techniques. So I will show you some examples that some of you sent to me before this webinar, and if there will be a need, we can organize much more webinars like that, where I will present to you my way of the meshing, and we can start some discussion. So point number five will be related to the life examples, and I will show you some problematic points that you were asking me. So let's start from the next slide. So I would like to say at the beginning what is, I would like to provide you some short answer what is finite element method. This is very important because we are talking about the mesh, and mesh is the part, very important part of this procedure. But basically what it is, we were talking about this several times, so I will I will say only a few things just to remind that. So basically this is a numerical method. A numerical method which has been adopted for structural engineering and sometimes even in CFD. So it's adopted for engineering generally speaking. In the same time, it is also a tool which is used for evaluation of structures and big complex systems. It can provide very accurate prediction of the response of the structures, structures which are subjected to the structural loads or thermal loads, because it's also possible. So FEA uses a complex system of points which are called nodes, and which creates a grid called a mesh, and this is the topic for today. So the mesh itself includes or is programmed to contain the material and structural properties which define how the structure will react to certain loading conditions. And what is more, nodes are assigned at a certain density throughout the material depending on the anticipated stress levels of a particular area. So we can easily figure out where that we can figure out that there are some regions which will receive large amounts of stress, and usually at these places the higher node density will be required. But this is something related to the procedure with the meshing. So that's all for the moment. So if we take a look on this picture, just to summarize quickly, if we have some physical model, this model must be divided into sub shapes like elements right now, so I will not say anything more. The process is called discretization, and after that, based on these elements, we can start to analyze our structure. So application of FEM is very, very wide. So generally speaking, can be used in the structural analysis, as I said. So we can analyze the bridges, some frames, cantilevers, automotive parts. The parts or assemblies can be analyzed under dynamic conditions, and so on. So there is a quite huge list about that. But what exactly is going on inside the mesh? So everyone, or maybe most of you, knows this this equation. So this equation is I hope familiar to you. So it's from simple physical description, it shows the Hooke's law, but this is not the point at this moment. But this equation provides us information what will be calculated inside our model. So this is a global, let's say, matrix equation with following parts like K, which is the stiffness matrix, and information about stiffness comes from the material, from the property mostly, and of course the shape of the structure. So property stands for the types of the element. So that's the point why the mesh is important. The next part of this equation is the delta. Delta stands for the vector that we are looking for. So for example, for the stress linear stress analysis, that's displacement. And to the right side of the equation, we have a vector like F, which can be force or other enforcement. So everything depends on the analysis type. And okay, so if you take a look on the next slide, this is exactly what I said. We are looking on the finite element method flowchart. So basically, we have some initial geometry to discretize. We can use the geometry. We can skip this step, and we can build our model directly from the mesh. But generally speaking, this mesh is the assembly of the local equations, local matrix form equations, which describes which stands for the describing law. So if each node is why the mesh is so the equations into
okay, so please excuse us. This is something were wrong actually with the connection, and I just changed the microphone. So everything is fine right now. So if you can let's say write to me if there is a need to back to the previous slide, I can back to the previous slide then. And just simply repeat. So we can continue, or I can back. So if you can write me some quick feedback, I will appreciate that. Okay, so most of you are saying to back to the previous one. Okay, so let's back to the previous slide. So basically, I started to talk about flowchart for finite element method, and about importance of the mesh, because we can start our job for using the geometry. For example, this is the way how most of us is doing. So the process to create the mesh is called discretization. And based on that, we are receiving our model. But we can start also directly using the tools that we have, for example, in Midas NFX as well. But our goal for that is to create a good representation of the structure. So this is, if we take a look on the picture below, we are seeing that every node on this picture, actually maybe not every, but most of the nodes, they are related with the local equation, which will describe the behavior of this structure. So on the previous slide there was a global matrix equation. Right now we have global balance equation, and now we have local balance equation. So this is what we are doing. So this equation also is related to the number of degrees of freedoms for each particular element, but I will tell you a bit later. So that's our goal to build like that. This is why it is also important to create good representation of the shape. So sometimes in the areas of the stress razors or in the sudden on the places where the geometry is changing suddenly, we have to increase this number of equations. This is basically what we are doing. So we are seeing this as the mesh, as the nodes, but basically we are providing, we are creating much more equations to describe the behavior of the structure. So this is what I was saying. So right now I'm talking about the element times, which are available in Midas and FX, and they are one of the most popular elements. So as you know, we have one dimensional elements, we have two dimensional elements, 3D, and some other special element types, and every type of the element has got unique feature. So basically, in terms of the geometrical properties, one dimensional element has got a length. For 2D, we have two dimensions which are describing the element, and we are not talking about the third dimension, and we have 3D elements which the main geometrical feature for that element is the volume. So the main geometrical feature for 1D, once again, is a length, for 2D is the area, and for the 3D there is a volume. And if we take a look to the right column, there is something, there is some feature that we have to add to describe the element behavior, actually to close the definition of the element, because for example, volume has got, as I said, three-dimensional element has got a volume, so in addition with density, we can create mass easily. So there is no other dimension, and value is not required. So this is only an example. So when we, let's go to the next slide, and let me tell you briefly about degrees of freedom. So degree of freedom, what is exactly this degree of freedom? So basically degrees of freedom for the model are the unknowns in the finite element analysis. And these degrees of freedom describe the displacement of the node in structural analysis. And generally speaking, it's possible to up to 6 degrees of freedom. So we are talking about the 3 translations and 3 rotations. So if you take a look on this page, in Midas and FX, one-dimensional elements like rod has got 4 degrees of freedoms, so it's possible to respond to constrain or to add additional features to the element based on that. So we have 3 translations, one rotational degree of freedom. For the bar we have 6 degrees of freedom. For the 2D element we have 5. Generally speaking, without drilling degree of freedom, that's the feature of the property. And for the 3D element, has got only 3 transactional degree of freedom. This is a very important table to remember, because the question is exactly, can we join together different types of the elements? And right now, let's switch to the Midas and FX, and let's create some simple models. So I will create some plate. So now I'm starting from the geometry, and I will sketch quickly the line. It can be even sketch like this at the angle. So now I'm hiding all of the guiders, and let's mesh it. Let's create some mesh for this plate. So I'm going to the map face. Let's set up division to 4, so we should get the node at the middle, and that's correct. So let's add some property, and let's keep this value as default. This is not so much important right now. I would like to show you what will happen exactly if we try to connect the element like this. So that's the first example, and let's create some one-dimensional elements. I'm going to create property again, and I will use bar element for this curve. So now I'm checking the section. Section allows you to add the section parameters more automatic based on the template that we have. So let's add some dimension, like 2 millimeters for the radius. So, and let's click on OK. So the model is almost ready. So now I'm going to the property to display the shape of the bar, and I'm going to go to constraint, and I will constrain this edge. So I'm selecting all of degree of freedoms. This is why I'm clicking on the fixed. And additionally, we can merge the nodes. This is not usually needed, because if we are using this method, NFX is merging automatically, but just in case, I'm merging the node. And let's add some force. And let's type the value like 1 newton on Y direction. So it's very easy to guess that we should receive some error, but this is what I want to show you. Oh, for example, in that case, there is no error, but we can take a look on the final result, what we have. So we can think why we are experiencing this kind of answer. So if we review the rest of the results, like if we display shell stress from this result, we can easily guess that something is wrong, the force is not transferred correctly by the node. So this exactly proves that in that case, displayed element, I'm talking about, displayed element doesn't have rotational degree of freedom, because as I said, plate has got 5 degrees of freedom and rotation around the normal to the plate is free. But we can fix that, for example, using the property, and this option can be easily found there. So if we want to include this drilling degree of freedom, we can click on OK, we can check it, and we can recalculate the model, and we can see what we have right now. So right now there is no sufficient deformation as in the previous time. So also this stress contour is a bit different. So this example actually is, it proves only the fact that we have to think how to connect them, the elements properly. So this is the first example, and right now we can try do something more. We will try to connect the plate with the solid. So we remember from the previous file, from the presentation, that plate has got 5 degrees of freedom, but solid has got 3 degrees of freedom. So we will try to connect them somehow. But before that, let's create this example very quickly. So I will sketch the box, and let's add some dimensions. Height will be 5, and add this, so we can make it a little bit longer, like 50. So for example, let it be our solid. Now using the extract, I can extract the face from the solid. So I'm clicking on the model, I'm going to the geometry, and I will translate the solid to create some kind of beam, which will consist of the plate and the solid element. So right now I'm going to the translate. So I'm in the geometry tab, I'm selecting the face that has been extracted, and I'm simply moving this face from this point to the middle of section. I'm clicking this symbol to get the value, the right value of distance. I'm clicking on preview, and as you see, the face has been moved. Okay, so we have this. I will hide the guiders for the better view, and let's mesh it quickly. So let's click on the mesh. Let's add some density. Let's set up the let's set up the density of the mesh. So I'm clicking on the number of divisions, and we will set up these edges to 2 elements. So as at like this, on along this edge, the division will be 1. And let's add 5 elements along this edge. In the same time, I can add the mesh seed for the plate, and we will mesh them together. So I'm going to the 3D mesher. Right now, I'm clicking on the map solid. I'm selecting the solid, and I'm clicking on the preview button to check if everything is correct. So let's click on a property and let's apply. So the geometry has been created. Let's do the same for the 2D mesh. Let's check the thickness of the plate. So it's 5 millimeters. So right now I'm clicking on the property. I'm changing the thickness. I'm changing the thickness to 5. And let's generate the mesh. So we more or less fine right now. Okay, so we have it. So let's merge the nodes. So I'm merging them. Let's add some constraint. So I'm fixing this side. So I'm selecting fixed button, so we can as well check all of the good video freedoms from that window. And let's click on OK. So the last thing left, I have to add some force. Force will act on zeta direction, so the value, let it be 50 newtons. Let's keep the 5 newtons, for example. And let's try to analyze this. So I think that there is some problem with the voice, because some of you are complaining that there is still some problem. Okay, thank you. So it seems that the problem is for some of you only, so not for everyone. So let's click on the analysis case and let's solve the model. And as we expected, actually as I expected, so probably you as well, the solution cannot be done because there is an error about factorization due to the singularity at rotation of y, rotation around y-axis. So if we take a look on this global coordinate system, something is wrong. There is no stiffness accordingly. There is no stiffness along the y direction. So we can easily check this by model analysis, but let's say not the type. So this is the problem why we cannot we cannot combine different types of elements. But maybe there is a simple, maybe there is another way that which allows us to create this kind of connection. So let's back to the presentation for the moment. And in this particular case, actually, I'm reading one of your comments. Okay, yes. So some of you is writing that the error should appear. So yeah. Okay. So how to fix this problem? Generally speaking, in the previous webinars, we were talking about elements which were calling rigid body elements. So, and the name of using the Nastran nomenclature was RBE2, but we never talked about interpolation elements. So actually, what is RBE3 element? So in that case, this interpolation element is very similar to the rigid body, and this element defines linear relationship between the nodal degree of freedoms, and this model, this type of element is used to distribute loads, mass upon the corresponding nodes and to constrain the displacement of the node by wide net average of the displacement of the other nodes. So the first node is called dependent and the rest are called independent nodes. This is very important. This is very similar way like to RBE3, but in that case, for the interpolation element, we are interpolating external condition to the one, and this is basically what I will do when we switch to the NFX again. So what we have to do, we have to relate this lack of the rotational degree of freedom from the solid to the shell. So how to do this? So let's go to the mesh, let's go to the create, and for that case I'm clicking on the other, and from that list I'm selecting the interpolation element. So this is the menu. So what we have to do? Sometimes it's very good to use this comment, which is show hide no ID. Simply saying, it will be much more easier to control which nodes will be included for averaging. So now I'm clicking to model, and I will hide all of the geometry, so I'm displaying the mesh only. So let's create the first element. So basically, I'm starting from this reference node. So I'm selecting the node number 18, and to distribute some loads, I'm selecting the nodes number 6 and node number 30. This is 3, 0. So from that node, my reference node number 18 will possess all of the rotations. So now I consider that the node stands on the solid side, on the shell side, but I have to average the translation because solid has got translations only. So I'm clicking on this. The weight factor will be 1, and let's click on again. So I edit this. Technically, I can add also the node number 24, but let's stay for this right now. Selection of the nodes is very important because we are talking about the interpolation. So if I select much more nodes, the result can be different than we are looking for. So I'm clicking on this, I'm clicking apply, and I'm creating the second element on the second side. So let's rotate the model, let's select node number 24, and let's add node number 12 and node 36, so the same, let's edit, and let's click on OK. So what I made, I create two interpolation elements, right now I'm hiding the solids, and you should be able to see the interpolation. Okay, so let's go to linear static, let's edit, let's add this interpolation element, let's click on OK, and let's solve the model again. So this time we have zero warning, so model has been calculated and we can display the results. Okay, so what we see, the result is very nice, it's pretty much proportionally, let's say, consistent, considering the distribution. So right now we are able to display the separately result for the solid elements, and in the same for the shell elements. How does it look like with the full solid geometry? So for that case, I will show you a similar model, but I will use the model which has been prepared previously by me. So let's display the results. So model to the right is 100% solid model, and combined model is to the left. So now we are able to probe the results, and we can compare the results from the nodes that we achieved. So there is almost no difference, even if we consider the points on the same plane. We can as well try to display the stresses, because right now I'm displaying the total translation vector, but if we display solid cornices, we see that the distribution of the stress is almost the same like for the original model. So this is why we are using interpolation elements to connect different type of topologies together. This is very important step. I'm not saying this is difficult, but let's say you can try on your own to make some similar model, and you will see that creating interpolation element using several nodes actually makes your solution much much more, let's say, difficult to explain. Oh, let's call it like that. So what you should know, it's very important to connect the elements in the right way, and we have to always investigate the result, we have to always check the value, we have to some of you are saying thank you for the use of interpolation element. You're welcome. This is why I made this for you. This is why we have to think about the result and the distribution, especially of the stress. It's very easy to get the nice displacement result, but in terms of the stress, this is something different. So every time when it's possible and when there is a need to use interpolation element, because I don't want to say that this is a solution for everything, because this is actually very technically difficult job, but in some cases you can use that. The only thing is that you have to practice how to do that. So more or less that was all about the first part of the today's webinar. Right now I would like to continue with the second part, which refers to the manual meshing techniques. And as I said, there are many manual techniques that you can use for your model, for your work, for your simulation. Everything depends on what actually tools you have. Let's say, what are the available tools by your system. So if you have tools that you can use it efficiently, that you understand the tools, you are able to create this mesh. The second factor is modeling experience. So if you spend a lot of time for the checking those tools, if you spend a lot of time to build if you spend a lot of time to create manual meshing, then you are able to figure out to predict the way how to create manual mesh quickly, effectively, where will be need to increase the number of elements, how to do that, how much time it will take, because it's also related to the complexity of the problem. It's also related to the analysis type. So, for example, if we consider the implicit dynamic solution and explicit dynamic solution, sometimes, actually many times, it's better to create mapped mesh because simply the solution it depends on the smallest element size. This is something which is related to the integration algorithm, and I'm talking about this during one of my previous webinars. So you can visit the meshing the webinar, which is called Short Event Modeling, and you will be able to get information about that. So other factors are approval requirements. So if there is some institution or approval office, sometimes they are required to get the mapped mesh, which where is no doubt about discontinuity. For example, it's very easy to verify your model, and in the same time, we are talking about the accuracy. So the last factor which comes to my head is the time, because manual meshing generally requires much more time because of all of the previous features that I said. So this is actually the big scope, how to treat the manual meshing techniques in terms of effective modeling. So on the next slide, I would like to present you some tools that I'm using frequently to create manual mesh. So you can find those tools in Midas NFX as well. So we are talking about the ProTube tools. To this group, we can include extrusion, revolving, sweeping, offsets. Very frequently, we'll use transformation tools just to copy your elements, to copy the nodes, to mirror, to scale the elements. Some direct tools like extraction of the elements, dividing algorithms. They are frequently used by myself, and of course mesh merging. So, but in the same time, to create mesh manually, you require to use additional tools, and there is a short list that will be helpful to create pretty nice or high quality mesh, pretty nice looking mesh and high quality mesh. So it's obvious that you will use measure, you will use the mesh seed to fix the seeding on some edges, on some faces. You will use the mesh grouping. This is actually not a tool, but this is a procedure which is related to the creation of the mesh set. So I'm pretty sure that you will use a lot of feature of the mesh set just to move some nodes from one group to another one to create sub meshes and simply to manage your model more effectively. So some geometry tools for editing existing geometries like mid-surface, like other tools that I will show you on the next example, and of course selection toolbar. So that's all what you actually, this is the minimum for the moment, I think, that you will have to use if you are thinking about manual meshing. So on the next slides, I prepared some examples. So this is an example of the 2D meshing, where we are using semi-automatic techniques, so some part of the mesh was created by AutoMeasure, and the second part had been created by manual tools. And in the same time, on the next slide, there is some example of the 3D meshes. But let's say now is a good time to back to the NFX, and I will present some workflow, for example, for this pipe, where I will use the geometry to help to create this pretty nice looking mesh. I will show you how to create the mesh for explicit analysis, for example, using the toy. And I will also show you some example about stress razors, and I will use them part of the ship section. So let's switch to the Midas NFX again. Okay. And let's close this model. And let's start modeling from that side. So every time before we start our job, we have to think what will be the workflow of what will be the procedure for creation of the 3D mesh. So at this stage, when I have this geometry, usually I know what I want to do, and what does it mean? It means that previously, for example, I made several simulations to investigate where the stress razors are, for example. So this is one of the examples. I made several simulations to study the behavior of the model. And after that, let's say, knowing this, I'm ready to create mapped mesh, because, for example, some of the approval institution will require this type of the mesh. So this is the assumptions right now that I'm sharing with you to start, for example, work on that mesh. So this on this elements, on this model. So this model comes from one of the other leads from the oil and gas industry. And let's create quickly the mesh. So now I'm clicking on the geometry, and I'm using the option which is called Show Only. And how to create 3D mesh? This is my task very quickly, skipping the automatic measure. So if you consider this geometry, we want to create a mesh for the pipe, and the geometry that we received is actually represents the rod. This is not the pipe. So what can we do? So of course we can go to this side of the model. We can create some circle on that face, and we can create 2D mesh. And after that, we can extrude the mesh along the length of the pipe. But this is good way, of course, but maybe it's not sufficient enough. So how to do this much more quicker using NFX? So I will go simply to the 2D mesh, and I will create 2D mesh using the geometry that I have. So now I'm clicking on the map face. I'm clicking at the geometrical face, and using the selection toolbar, this is what I mentioned on the last slide, I'm using, of course, this feature angle, which is in my case 30. I will select all of them, all of the faces very quickly. So this is one click. So having that, I'm going to change the size, and in that case, let's enter the 50. So we have this. So we can think if the number of elements around the circle is fine. So I think it's not good enough. So I can go to the size control, and I will add mesh density. So now I'm selecting all of the curves. Which require the seeding. Let's add 6 elements per edge, so we have 4 edge per section. So I'm clicking on this. Again, we have to select all of the faces, and let's click on the preview. So right now it looks much more better. So let's click on OK, and let's see the final result. So from that moment, the geometry is not needed anymore. So I hide this geometry, and I can hide all of the guiders and the work plane. So what I created, this is a 2D representation of the of the geometry. So at this moment, now I can start to think if there is any place that I should increase the number of the elements. So for that, I'm displaying the geometry again. I'm clicking on the top view, and because as I told you before, this is my assumption. I studied the model. I know that this part of the model is crucial, let's say, and I have to increase the number of the elements because the boundary conditions looks like following. So later on that place there will be a contact, so it will be better to increase slightly the number of the elements. So how to do that? So I'm going to the element group. I will basically delete some of the model. In the same time, I'm selecting all of these elements. So I'm clicking on OK. I'm hiding the geometry. So I'm working again with the mesh only. So as you see, it looks like this. I can back to the previous view, and I can simply go to the extrude command, and having this information, I can create elements to close this gap. So the command is 1D to 2D. I will use the element edge to 2D element. I'm selecting all of the edges from the elements. Knowing this dimension is not important because we have this tool for the measurement at the same time. So the global axis is X. So even it's not important to have all of these components, we can select any nodes. We can click on this icon to get the actual size, and we can go to preview. So as you see, the elements have been extruded. And using this command, we can increase the number to 15. We can go and check if the nodes are matched. And we can click on OK. So I increase this number of elements at this section. And considering the rest of the model, the procedure will be exactly the same. So what I can do right now is to create the solid elements. I can merge my mesh sets together. So right now I'm clicking on the extrude mesh. I'm drag and drop this into map mesh 2D. I'm clicking OK. And one fully merged mesh has been created. Now I can as well go to the topology, and I can check if my mesh has been merged in the proper way. So there are some free edges. This is very important step to check every time, even if you are extruding or not. Probably I made some mistake that the distance was not good. Let's say maybe the geometry was not so much perfect and there is still some gap. But anyway, I know this. So what I can do right now is simply go to the merge, and I can decrease the tolerance, for example 0.1, and we can see and what will happen. So if I go back again to the check tool, if I display the feature edges, right now my model is clean. So based on that, now I know the model is fine, and I can create the pipe. So how to do this quickly? So for example, we can use the offset for the elements. Sorry, I will rotate the model in the second way, just to see the result on for the offset. So now I'm using selection toolbar. I'm clicking on the select all, and let me enter the value, and let's click on preview to see the direction of the offset. So I think it's going outside, and in the same time we are expecting to extrude the elements inside. So that's the right direction. Maybe we can increase the thickness, and we can click on OK. So this is how I created the 3D mesh for this particular model. Okay, so this is one of the examples how to work with 3D. Of course, every way, as I said, depends on the shape of the model, on the analysis type. So there will be different requirements. So right now, I would like to show you a second example. For example, for this sheep section. And many times we are dealing our job with the 3D geometries. So you know exactly that in Midas NFX there is a Simplify tool, which is dedicated for geometric cleaning for the searching the bad features, for searching small faces, spikes, and so on. But it's very efficient for the 3D for the 3D elements. So what if we have some problems with the 2D shapes? So for example, let's take this part of the ship section. Let's click show only. And what we can do, because this is a solid, we can still go to simplify, and we can still search for small edges, for example. So as you see, something has been found. So at the same time, we discover that there are several edges at this part of the model. So this is basically the error of translator, or simply saying the geometry is not perfect. So what can we do? So of course we can, as I said, go to simplify, and we can try to clean that. But this is valid only when we have solid. But what if we have 2D? So to do that, I will create mid-surface first. So I used the tool which is called Make Neutral Sheet, and I used automatic command. So technically, it's not possible right now to investigate, to figure out the wrong areas. So how to do this? So when we have this geometry, we are going to the merge face edge. So this is very efficient tool. We are changing the simple shape. And since we are clicking on the shape, now we have an information that there are a lot of small edges. So what we can do with this geometry from this point, for example, someone gave us this geometry with so many errors. So we can try to fix this by the just mentioned tool, but sometimes simply saying even this is not possible. So I will try to do this again, and I will try to merge those curves. So as you see, even right now, the result is not satisfied. Okay, so what can we do? The answer is very simple. There is almost nothing to do except of the fact that we have to edit this geometry. So how to do this quickly, let's say, and what to do with that? So we can go to the explode. So there is explode command. So right now I'm preparing the geometry for the mesh. So this is what we are doing. So I'm clicking on explode. Level of explosion. I'm setting this to the edge, and I'm simply selecting this face. We can delete this original file, this original geometry, or we can keep this. So I will not check that. So I'm clicking on OK, and I will hide the geometry. So what I have right now, I have the representation of the geometry in by curves, let's say. So this is bound of the geometry. So right now I will go to the points. I will sketch some points, and I will simply delete them using the selection toolbar as well. So if I go to this menu, you can change this to the edge. So right now, everything what I will select will be filtered by the edge. And I'm pressing delete button, and I'm deleting this shape. So using the polyline, I can quickly fix this. I'm checking the make face. And now I have it. So this is exactly how to fix that. If you want to remove the points, we can simply go to the point, we can press the delete, and have using the face comment, we can recreate the face very quickly. So now we have it. If we check this again, the result should be much more better. And considering the shape for the meshing, there is something that we can do as well. So let's say, because we have a lot of shape, actually there is a hole, so we can assume that some stress concentration will appear in that section. So how can we prepare the geometry for the meshing? So this time I will go to the tool which is called offset. I will select all of the curves. I will select this and this circle, and let's see on the results. So we see that we can offset the edges, we can increase the number to 13, and I made it. So we are going, the next step is to go to the imprint. So we are selecting the face, we are selecting all of the curves, direction of the shortest path line, that's the option that I will use, and I'm clicking on OK. I'm hiding the curves from the menu, from the geometry set. Okay, and you see right now that the curves have been imprinted. What is the result of that? If we go to the mesh, and if we go to the map face, we can select them separately. We can change the size to 20, for example. We can see the result. So now we see that mesh looks looks nice. Actually, there is something to do that we can do more to with this hole. But let's say let's skip this. So I decrease the size of the mesh. And I'm clicking on apply. And right now, if I go to the auto face, so that's the comment for the auto measure, I can create less quality mesh for the other parts. If let's say this is my my focus area of focus, so I can go to this auto mesh. We can change the element type from the triangles to the both elements. So basically I will create free mesh. I'm clicking on OK, and this is the final result. So the mesh at the area of interest has been improved drastically. The rest, if there is any, if we know actually, and if we understand the behavior of the model, is not important. Okay, so it was the second example, and the final one is this example that I want to show you. So basically this is the toy of the, this is the toy, this is a car, and I would like to show you some features for the divide, for the division of the elements, and some feeling, and and some fill features. So I will display only those geometries, and we will create map solid mesh very quickly. So again, I'm going to the geometry. I'm going to simplify. This time I'm clicking on the manual, and I will merge faces. So I'm selecting this option, merge faces, and I'm clicking on remove merge. So I'm clicking on OK. And let's create some mesh. So for example, if we go to the 3D mesher, and if we select this part, we can create some tetra mesher, which is tetra mesh, excuse me, which is not our goal. There are two, there are a lot of elements, and for example, as I said, for the explicit is not the best solution. So what can we do more? We can change the mesher to the hybrid mesher, and we can see the result from that. So it looks a little bit better, but this is, again, this is not the result that we want to achieve. So what we will do? Basically, I will go to 2D mesh, and I will select this face. But before that, I have to select map face, because I'm starting from the map face. So I'm clicking on this face again, and I'm clicking on the preview. So this is the mesh, which is fully quad mesh at this moment. Of course, there are some places that can be, let's say, meshed in better way, but this is not the point for the moment. And I'm clicking on apply. And right now we have two options. We can, for example, use fill tool. So if I go again to the 2D mesh, and if I create the mapped meshing on the bottom side, I'm using the same size of the element, so I was checking that before, and in that case my mesh is consistent with the top one, so I can create this, and having these elements I can use fill tool to create 3D mesh. So the first comment is select top or bottom element, so it is written bottom, but it can be top as well. Select the elements from the second side, and we can go to preview. Oh, and as you see, this is quite interesting, because it seems that the number of the element is different. So very good. So what to do instead of this? I can go to undo, and I can, for example, use different tool, which is called project. So again, let's select all of the elements. Let's select surface to project. So in that case, it will be my bottom one. And the projection direction will be set up to the shortest path line. So from that side, from this place, I'm thinking how many divisions I'm looking for. So I will go to preview, and as you see, the mesh looks very, very nice. So let's change this value to 3, for example, and let's click on OK. So what we made? I created 3D mesh from 2D mesh using the projection tool. So that's the first part of this model. So let's go to automatic 3D mesher. Let's map this solid, and let's mesh it like that. So what if you have to connect the mesh on the one side, which consists of two elements per face, and on the other side you have only one element, and it will be better to use mapped meshing. So basically, we have to edit this mesh manually. So I'm hiding the geometry right now, and I will show you quickly the procedure. So basically, what we have to do, we have to delete this element, And okay, let's hide and let's delete again. Probably I didn't select all of them, so okay. So we have this this situation like right now. So what can we do? How to create the connection manually? So we have to go to the create element, for example, and we have to create quadrilateral element. This is the first step. So now I'm selecting the nodes to create simple plate. And I'm clicking on OK button. I have it. If you go to the divide tools and having clicking on this 2D button, you will get an access to several division methods. So basically for 2D we can use pattern of two or pattern of three elements. So it's up to you. So in that case, I want to use pattern of two because on the one edge I have one element and on the second side I need two elements. So for that case, this Sagan algorithm will be fine for me. So I'm clicking, I'm selecting this of this element. Now I have to select proper nodes. So as you see at the picture, there are nodes to select, so we have to make a decision. So I'm selecting this node, and I'm clicking on preview, okay? We have it. That's fine. So let's hide the mapped mesh, and let's fix this geometry. How to do that? I'm going to extrude. Now I'm able to extrude this from 2D to 3D. So I'm selecting two nodes. I'm clicking the length. I'm setting the division into one. And I'm clicking on preview. OK. And it seems it looks good. So now I'm clicking on apply. And I extruded the element. And right now I don't need anymore this manual 2D mesh. And my next step will be to make a copy of these elements along that edge. So I'm clicking on the translate. I'm selecting this mesh set. Again, I'm selecting the nodes to catch the distance. I'm clicking on this icon. And I'm selecting as the method copy. And I will copy this model seven times, and I'm clicking on OK. So what is the result? We see there is a gap. From this side, it looks very, very nice. But from this side, we have to do something with this as well. So what we have to do, we have to move the nodes to create connection. So let's go to the merge. As you see, the merge is a very useful tool. And right now, I'm unchecking this merge nodes at the center location. It's mandatory to display, to click on show height node ID. And using the proper method, we have to select them. So this one, this node is the lowest. This one is the lowest. This one is the highest. So the smallest ID will be the base node. The second will be like that, and let's click on apply. I move that. And in the same time on this side, and I'm clicking apply, I move that. So we have to also move this middle node. And for that, you can create a line, for example, like I'm creating a line, so there is a geometry. I'm going back to the mesh. I'm clicking on the translation. This time I'm clicking on the nodes, I'm selecting the node, and as the vector I'm selecting the same node and the middle point of the edge that I created just to move it. And I'm clicking on OK. So I moved this node, now I'm hiding the IDs of the elements. I'm going to the merge. I'm using measurement tool. So distance is 0.2. And let's enter 0.1 as the tolerance. And let's merge. Let's try to merge them. So probably we have to increase this value. And as you see, the model has been merged. So basically, that's all what I prepared today for you. Sorry that it took much more time than it was assumed at the beginning, but this is what I wanted to show you and give you some kind of ideas how to approach the meshing. So if you have some questions, you can leave the questions on the chat or you can email directly to me. One of you is asking if it's possible to connect quickly shell and solid using welded contact. It is very, it's very important question, but like I say, everything depends how we have to connect that. If there is no problem to connect them directly, if the faces are touching themselves, for example. But in other case, we are waiting for the next feature, which is called edge contact, and this will be provided soon, and there will be no problem. Okay, I think there are no questions today, so I would like to thank you for participating this this session. I'm sorry for the sound problems, and I hope it was useful for you. So see you next time on the next webinar. The topic will be related to the CFD analysis, so we will talk about the basics of CFD next time. And that's all. Thank you so much. Just to finish this conversation, I am sending to all of you my email address. And see you next time. Goodbye.